So I'd like to start by thanking the Allen Foundation to invite me to present our work here, especially invite me at the very beginning of the project, that the funding for which is going to start in a few months. And so if I say we, I present a project that is a collaboration between my own lab at EMBL and Ralf Jungmann's group at the Max Planck Institute for Biochemistry in Munich. And so what we propose to do to the Allen Foundation is to develop new technology to map epigenetic marks to the 3D architecture of the human genome in single human cells with single gene resolution. And so to introduce this, I want to step back a little bit and remind you that in addition to all the fantastic technology developments we've heard about in genomics and different types of sequencing methods, we are at the same time living in an era where we also have revolutionary technologies that come from imaging technologies. And so in the era of cryo-electron microscopy that has just been awarded the Nobel Prize a few weeks ago in chemistry, but also in the era of super-resolution microscopy that was awarded the Nobel Prize 3 years ago. And so what these technologies allow us to do is they allow us to zoom in and out of living systems now in an almost seamless way. There are no longer any resolution gaps that can no longer be bridged. And so this is really transformative for life science because crossing scales is very important in biology. I think most of us are in life science because we are motivated by questions that come at the organismal level, that come at the physiological level. We heard about this very beautifully this morning in the opening lecture. But if we want to rationally explain those questions, we have to get to the digital matter of life, which is macromolecules. This is something we can understand in terms of structure and function. And we have to get at the cellular scale where life exists for the first time because many such macromolecules interact with each other. And so understanding disease without being able to go down to the molecules and go back up to the physiology is not possible. And so life simply is multiscalar, and you have to ask your question at the right scale in order to make any progress. Now, a classical example of a multiscale problem is the architecture of the genome. And the previous speakers already beautifully introduced why we don't just have to understand the architecture of the DNA, but actually also understand the architecture of the regulatory marks on the DNA. But it's a fundamental problem at many scales. And so we know quite well what DNA looks like at the atomic scale. We have a good idea what a nucleosome, as the core packaging unit of DNA inside a nucleus, looks like. But then above that scale, our knowledge fades out because we are no longer able at the moment to do the structural analysis in a physiologically meaningful way. And at the cellular scale, on the very right of this slide, the only thing we really know is that the chromosomes inside a nucleus are not overlapping very much. They each occupy their own territory. And so this gap in the knowledge was mostly motivated technically. We had the structural methods, crystallography, electron microscopy. They went up to a nanometer or so in scale, and we had the light microscopy methods that went down until about 200 nanometers. And exactly between those scales of 1 nanometer and 200 nanometers is where all the fun of genome architecture happens. And so you just couldn't look at that. So now there are technologies that can look into this gap and that can look into this window. And so the question is, can we learn something from that about new genome architecture? And so to consider this in a context of a human cell, which I think for many of us is what we're interested in, there's a few numbers that are useful. If you think about the real dimensions of the human genome and the real dimensions of a nucleus, then on a standard diffraction-limited microscope, you can resolve about 2 megabase pairs of genomic distance. That's not a very useful unit. That contains many, many genes and many, many regulatory elements, tens of thousands of nucleosomes. Now, if we go to the Nobel Prize-winning super-resolution methods, now we can bring this resolution down by about an order of magnitude, but the genome is folded in 3D, so it's really 3 orders of magnitude difference that we can resolve, and that means theoretically we should be able to resolve 2 kilobase pairs of DNA inside a nucleus, even without using what we just heard about, expansion microscopy, to blow up the nucleus even further. So that should be possible, and I just want to illustrate what that difference in resolving power means with old data from our group, where we looked at the surface of the nucleus and looked at the gates that govern the exit and entry to and from the genome. So on the left, you see what that looks in a diffraction-limited microscope. That's a whole nucleus of a human cell. And each dot you see is one of these gates, the nuclear pore complexes that govern all the transport in and out of the nucleus. So you can see where they are. but you cannot see anything about their structure because their diameter inside is only 50 nanometer below the diffraction limit. So super resolution microscopy allows you to zoom in on that, what you see in the middle, because you visualize only individual fluorescent molecules, but you can see that's a very blurry image if you just take one of it. But what super resolution microscopy does, it takes many, many, many thousands of these individual fluorescent images, and from knowing where these molecules emit, reconstructs a super resolved image. And so you can see that reconstruction live on the right side, and you can see the ring architecture of the channel coming up in the super resolved image. And so the inside of this is not just 40 nanometers, a few nucleosomes wide gap in the surface of the nucleus. So that worked for a long time in two dimensions, and pores are more or less a two-dimensional problem, but the genome is a three-dimensional problem. And only for about 2-3 years are we able to do this now in 3D. And you can see again here 3D reconstructions of the nuclear pores, now with newer technologies, to a resolution of about 8 nanometers. So our resolving power is sufficient to address this problem in principle. So if we do computational data analysis, for example, of the pore, you can see fluorescence-based 3D architecture maps of the protein complex on the top. And we can compare that to the other Nobel Prize winning technology, cryo-EM, at the bottom. And you can see that the layering of these rings of proteins is exactly the same, whether you look at it by fluorescence or whether you look at it by cryo-EM. So you get real protein architecture, structural information now out of a light microscope. So that's great, but what does it do for looking at the genome? So here, the problem is more complicated because you don't have such a regular symmetric architecture. You have a very unregularly folded architecture of the DNA, and also we need to look at different scales at the problem. So we know a lot about genome architecture from biochemical methods, mostly using cross-linking and sequencing, similar to what we've heard already during the meeting. And so that has given rise to the model illustrated on the left side, that there are along a chromosome domains of DNA that cluster and are topologically associating, so-called TADs or topologically associating domains. They typically map quite well to different patterns of epigenetic marks that are associated with different activities of the genomes, and they are markers for that. And so the model why that is the case is explained in the loop area of the slides. You have inactive, completely void domains that are strongly compacted, strongly looped, and then active domains are more highly looped and more open, and in between you have repressed domains where the loops are folded on top of each other. But that's a pure fantasy at the moment. We have never been able to directly see such structures. The only thing we know is the cross-linking and where on the linear genome sequence the epigenetic marks reside. So it would be very nice to be able to look at that directly with spatial information. And so that was the proposal we made to the foundation, and they liked it. So they said, try to do that, try to do it in the next 3 years to develop technology. Now, where are we at the moment? What we can do at the moment is we can fluorescently label these individual TAD domains. We take advantage that they replicate the DNA at the same time. So if we pulse a fluorescent nucleotide during replication and then dilute that to a single chromosome, we can label all the TADs in a single chromosome in a living cell nucleus. So that gives us already some information about the structure of these relatively large half megabase pairs domains. So here again, we use the power of super resolution microscopy. When you can compare the diffraction limited to the storm image, you can see each of these large domains decomposes into the individual replication forks that were active at the time you introduced the nucleotide. That allows us now to do some measurements. We can measure how big these domains are. On average, they are only about 150 nanometers. And how many forks you need to replicate one, and that's typically 4 replication forks. You need to replicate one of these. Now, in additional experiments, I don't have time to show at this level of the TAD. What we've been able to measure is that these 150 nanometer size domains are spaced approximately every 300 nanometers along the chromosomal molecule. And they are very dynamic, so they're only very elastically coupled to each other. And already 500 nanometers away from one domain, the next neighboring domain no longer knows mechanically that it's on the same chromosome. It's completely free to move independent of that neighboring domain. So this allows us to formulate a data-driven model for what a chromosome looks like inside the nucleus and also how much mechanically the information is propagated. But what we really don't know yet is what does the inside of one of these domains look? What is the loop architecture inside the domains. And that's what everybody at the moment wants to understand. What do these things really look like inside? So for this, we need to go away from a pure replication labeling where you don't have sequence specificity and you don't know which genomic locus are you interrogating, to a method where you know that. And so here again, advances in omics technologies come to our rescue. We can use methods where we use fluorescence in situ hybridization probes that have sequence specificity, but we don't label the probes directly, but rather encode the fluorophore in a little docking strand onto which you can bind a short oligonucleotide with the fluorophore. And so in this barcode of 9 nucleotides, you can now encode multiple colors by sequentially adding such imager strands to different barcodes to your substrate. So that in a model chromosome here, if you take linearized M13 phage chromosome onto a piece of glass, you can walk your way with such barcoded FISH probes in 10 positions along this piece of DNA, spaced about every 600 base pairs apart. And you can then sequentially label them one after another, record super resolution data, and you can indeed reconstruct distances below a few hundred base pairs on a piece of in vitro DNA. Now, if we would like to do this for the whole human chromosome at this distance, we would need tens of thousands of FISH probes and tens of thousands of cycles of storm microscopy. And we probably don't want to wait that long because the kind of image that you would have is a sea of dots where you just have fluorescent dots everywhere. And we've seen similar images just in the previous talk. So the question is, how much combinatorial barcoding do you need to reconstruct the whole genome at a given genomic distance? And so to estimate that, we made a computer simulation and said, how many colors would you need at the optical resolution that current microscopy delivers in order to reconstruct the genome? I won't go into the details of the algorithm. This is published work. But the outcome of that essentially is if you have a microscope with better than 30 nanometer 3D, and that's important, resolving power, and you have 10 different colored probes with exchange DNA paint, it's very easy to do. You should be able to resolve already 50% of the genome at a few kb resolution inside a single nucleus. So theoretically, this should work. And so that motivated us to do experiments and now translate this approach into human nuclei that are carefully natively fixed so that the real architecture is preserved, because we really want to look at it at the nanoscale and then tile ourselves along the DNA of the human nucleus. And so hopefully next time I can come here, I can already tell you what the inside of a TAD looks like and how many loops are really there and how big they are and all of that. But that's still at the DNA level. And so what about the epigenome? You know, now I've shown you that in principle, if you use super resolution microscopy and you combine it with smart computation of the data, you can look at the 3D architecture of the DNA molecules inside the nucleus. That's fantastic. But what do we do with the function information? The function information often is not encoded just in the DNA sequence, but in the epigenetic marks. And so we would like to do the two together. And that's really the proposal for the next 3 years for Ralf and my own group to develop this. And so the key to this is to develop a different kind of probe, to use a hybrid probe that is able to detect specific DNA sequences and at the same time, specific epigenetic modifications. And so that way, using a similar combinatorial approach that I introduced to you for the genome mapping, we can then in very high throughput do the super resolution imaging, reconstruct the image data, and assemble at the single cell level three-dimensional epigenome maps, where the ambition is to develop technology where for every gene and its regulatory elements, we could call the epigenetic modifications. So the secret to doing this is partially in the probes, and so I just want to briefly give you an idea what Ralf is working on at the moment in Munich. So he's designing oligopaint DNA probes who will only give rise to a complementary docking sequence to a fluorophore-bearing DNA strand if they are in close proximity to an antibody-based reagent that recognizes the epigenetic modification. So only if these two things happen at the same time, you bind to a specific genomic sequence and you bind within a few nanometers to an epigenetic mark, do you have a template where your fluorophore can bind to. So that immediately gives you both information, where am I in the genome and what type of epigenetic mark is present. And again, we can use the same type of multiplexing strategy I explained for genome mapping to deconvolve that information and in 3D in the nucleus call all the modifications on the different genes. So there's work to do for the next 3 years. I hope if we make it work with the generous support from the Allen Foundation, that what we'll be able to deliver is the 3D architecture of the epigenome in single cells with single gene resolution. So that's the plan for the future. I hope I'll be back in 3 years to report on the results to some of you. Before I do that, I want to thank the people in the lab that have prepared us to get to this stage. And so work on the nuclear pore was led importantly by Shotaro Otsuka, and work on the TAD imaging was led by Maria Julia Roberti and Wang Qingchang. And I'm very grateful to our external funders for this project, the Allen Foundation, and to Ralph and the great collaboration we have between Heidelberg and Munich. And I'm happy to take any questions.
We have time for a few questions.
Hi, does this one work or should I go there? Can you hear people?
You can shout.
Okay. Well, so your 30 nanometer resolution that leads to 50% of the genome, like, oh, thank you. So in your simulations, if you look to the kind of functional form of that, i.e. obviously Ralph's shown much higher resolution in some of his DNA paint technologies,
yes,
you know, 5 nanometers or even better. Like, how does that work? If you get a little bit better resolution in 3D, does it lead you to a very larger amount of the genome you can map? What's the function?
Yeah, so the at some point you don't gain so much anymore. So these are asymptotic curves, and in the paper that will be soon out in PLOS Computational Biology, but which is already on bioarchive, we ran all those games, you know. Another nanometer, how much more genome percentage does it buy you?
So
essentially, at some point, the main thing where you gain is the quality of your probe library, that you don't miss locations that you're trying to map. So the algorithm that reconstructs the information from a limited set of barcodes is relatively dependent on not having too many gaps in the sequence, because what it's constantly trying to do is to match the known linear sequence of the genome, where you know what you expect in terms of your barcode order, to the entangled 3D picture that you get in the microscope. And so when you miss many positions, that fails. Yeah, so at some point, above 50 nanometer resolution, you almost completely depend on the quality of your probe library.
Okay, great, thanks.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thanks.